Welcome to MBS Show Special. This is Norman Sanzo. I've just watched the My Little Pony movie, and I have some friends here.
Hello.
Hi.
So, let's introduce from my left, Julie the Dragon.
Hi, everyone.
And I forgot to ask you, what do you want to be called? Because I know your real name. I'm not sure if you want to tell everybody in the world. So, how would you like to be addressed?
I'm just Ash.
Ash. Alright, yes. Now I remember the YouTube. What's your YouTube channel again?
Eccentric. Hard to pronounce. Maybe we'll leave a link in the description or something.
Yes, something like that. But still, me and my friends, we watched the My Little Pony movie. Ash is a bit special because she's working for the press. So she gets early access to the movie. But, well, let's go in. Well, let's try not to go spoilerish, but let's try something. So anyhow, how do you guys like the movie? Like, personally for me, I kind of like it. Like, I really enjoyed it. And you, Dragon?
Well, I enjoyed it. I have to say it was a little more than I expected.
Really now? What do you mean by that?
Well, again, we're not trying to spoil anything. So, it's an MLP movie. At the end of the day, it was, well, it worked out well, as far as I'm concerned.
All right. What about you, Ash?
Well, having watched it twice, my opinion has changed slightly because it seemed to have gotten better second time around because I missed a pretty important part of the movie the first time around.
So wait, you told me earlier before we recorded that you were writing a review for it. So does it change, like, does your overall opinion change from your initial viewing to the second one?
Very slightly. But my stance on the movie is still about the same.
Alright.
Because my opinion about the movie is like, if you were a kid watching it and the parents, I'd give you a different rating. And if you were a fan watching it, I'd give it a different rating as well. Because like, I can't speak for both at the same time.
Like, fair enough.
As a fan, I felt that maybe it's more interesting, like the animation value is better, a lot of familiar voices to be had, some of the new characters are really great. But as a kid, you just want the pretty colors, the parents want the PG rating, and they want nice songs and, you know, flash, flash, boom, boom.
Alright. So, Ash, do you consider yourself a fan or casual?
I'm a fan. Right, fan. Right. Don't doubt me.
you didn't show your colors, that's why. But yeah, as for me, I say I like it. And yeah, the whole movie experience thingy going into it. Okay, a lot of people have told me about the movie, like how it is. Expect yourself not to... It says like, expect it to be bad kind of thing. And to be honest, I like it. Like, I knew what to expect. Like, people said it was a rush job, something like that. It felt rush. And here's the thing. You've been watching My Little Pony for 7 years now. If you want to add more, you include the Equestria Girl line of stories. And everything's a rush job. Like, trust me. Season 7 ender, season 6 ender, season 4, 5, and so on. It's rush, including the Equestria Girls movie 1, 2, 3, 4, and a lot of their sex machina is there. So for this movie, yeah, I was expecting it. I was surprised if it was not there.
Well, the thing is, the movie was only an hour and 39 minutes. I did feel it was kind of rushed, but if you are used to the show, yeah, I didn't feel it was rushed. You mentioned that someone told you that it was rushed, but I didn't feel the rush too much either. There was a segment in the very near the very end, I think about 20 minutes before the show ended. It was probably the only thing it was rushed. Now, I'm not going to spoil it, so I'm not going to say which part is it, but that was for the, what, 3 minutes, I felt that piece was rushed.
What, 3 minutes? That's near the ending? Like,
No. 20 minutes before the ending.
Ah, okay.
20 minutes before the ending, there was a segment, a small segment that I felt it was rushed. But that's the only part. You know, I'm not going to say what it is, of course.
You know, ladies and gents, he's telling me all this, and I just watched the movie, and I don't even know which part he's talking about. So this is how not in sync this is to me. Like, people say it's rush. I don't think so. even though if I do think so, I don't really see it, yeah. But
In order to not to spoil, I'm not going to say whether. I'll tell you later.
Yeah. But Ash, what do you think? Like, do you agree with us?
I'm going to give you a really, really, really unpopular opinion right now. In terms of pacing, I think this movie was better than Batman vs. Superman.
I don't think anyone's going to disagree with you.
Yeah, though. I mean, like, everybody knows that. Like, okay, Batman vs. Superman, that one was a crap show. The whole story could have been solved if the two heroes, quote-unquote heroes, just talk. Like, think about it. You have Batman who says that even there's a chance that he might be evil. Like a 1% chance. We must take it as absolute. Like, 1%? Dude, do you know your animated counterpart has countermeasures for almost everything and he still treats Clark like a buddy?
No, he treats Clark like a human.
Like, friend, buddy, human, but still. Oh, boy. But Zack Snyder's Batman, whatever it is, that's besides this point.
Yeah, but that was terrible.
You can clearly tell that I do not like that movie. I didn't go watch it, I did pay for it. And I can moan and grumble about it. But what you say is kind of true, yeah? And do you guys agree that could this problem be solved by talking or not?
Which problem? Just confirm for the audience.
The My Little Pony movie.
Like, No.
Like, when I say Batman, it could be easily solved by the two heroes talking.
Right.
Can this movie be solved by the antagonist and protagonist talking?
No.
Nah. Not possible.
No. Just before I spoil anything, the purple bad guy in the show,
Tempest, yeah.
She's
Tempest.
Already been mentioned, right?
Yes. Yeah,
so Tempest would not be able to talk it out. No way. Yeah. She was.
It's not that she can't. She doesn't want to.
I still think she can't, but that's my opinion, lah. But
anyway. Actually, Twilight did try. Remember that one part where, maybe we can talk it out, something like that.
Is that part of spoilers?
Well, come on, it's the very beginning of the show, so it's like.
And Twilight would try to make friends with anybody and everybody. So yeah, that's kind of a given. Fair enough.
Yeah, it's like. She tried, at least. So, I mean, you can't say that, oh no, Twilight is just one bad person. Like, she just goes in and fights like Batman would do. But no, I'm really...
That would just spoil the show for everybody.
But no, talking about new characters, we have Tempest, Storm King, Capper, the small...
Grubber.
The... Sea Pony, or is it the Princess and Queen?
I think they are called Sequestrians.
Sequestrians?
I think so.
I'll tell you something later. It has something to do with the season 7 finale.
That is one episode I haven't seen yet.
It has something to do with the season 7 finale, but that is another discussion for another day.
Okay.
But what do you guys think about the characters? Like, Ash, what about you? In any order you like, in all of the 7 characters, was it? 6.
Right. Thereabout. I really, really like Tempest Shadow. She's not as one-dimensional as usual MLP villains tend to be. Because, like, I mean, you've seen them all. You've seen Discord in the early days. You've seen T-Rex. You've seen Sombra. All throwaway villains. And to be perfectly frank, Storm King is not too different.
Storm King, I think, is a bit different in terms of his... goals. He is an established villain who knows what he wants and who is already getting it. That's what I think of him. His personality is all over the place. I think he's cocky and overconfident.
Yeah, that's probably the case.
Mm.
And he needs to spend more on his marketing budget.
I know.
Anyway. But yeah, she's not really one-dimensional. She has her reasons why she turned bad, and I believe she's got more backstory elaborated in the
novel, in
the comics, I think.
Okay, before going into this movie, there exists the My Little Pony movie prequel comics. There's 4 issues, starting with King, the Storm King, Pirates, Capper, and then lastly is Tempest. So they explain a bit of the backstory for each of these characters, like how the Storm King invaded this one country. And then how Capper had to escape the country and then got involved with the pirates. And then how the pirates got involved with the Storm King. And then suddenly Tempest came around. And it explains a bit of the character's backstory, and I would say go read it before you go watch the movie if possible. If not, like, you didn't read it, right?
No, nope. I didn't.
Neither did I.
So, experience ruined or not?
Nah, not really.
Nah, not really. But I would still pick it up after the movie to find out more about the characters, I mean.
Definitely.
Yeah. Spoiler, so I can't say what I just wanted to say, but
good catch.
Yeah. So that's Tempest. But what about the rest? Like, we're still on you with characters.
Again, I feel that the Storm King is a little bit of a throwaway villain. Like, I find that some movies these days have this thing I call Sephiroth syndrome. They talk about the character nonstop. Like, there's some just super big threat, they need to stop it. It's really, really bad. But the bad guy shows up for, like, this long, and then, like, towards the end of the movie, for, like, maybe 5 or 10 minutes maximum, and then they get defeated, and that's the end. The heroes win, the day is saved. That kind of stuff.
I see what you mean by the Sephiroth syndrome, because we all... The main heroes for 7, they talk about, oh, Sephiroth do this, Sephiroth do that, he's very evil. And to prove the point, Sephiroth killed this one character in the game. So it's like, oh my god, he's so bad because he killed one of the main characters. We can use Phoenix Down, right? No, story plot contrivers doesn't work. So, oh no, main character sad. So,
main characters actually run around killing people all the damn time. Nobody bats an eyelid.
You know, Phoenix Down cannot be used because it was not a battle.
No comment. That I could go on, but
yeah, let's not.
But the thing is, yes, I do agree with you that the Storm King is kind of a throwaway character. But I do like his personality, and I was a bit disappointed with how they portrayed him. He is kind of that goofy. Okay, how do I put this? Do you guys remember the 1994 Street Fighter movie?
Oh, that was bad.
I don't think I remember that.
That was terrible.
Yeah, but do you remember M. Bison? Like, how his character is like, and whatnot. Like, he is one of those goofy characters that, oh my god, you're so bad, but I enjoy you. And I think the Storm King's done. Like, I really like that.
Okay, like, I'm sorry. You said Street Fighter movie and Bison. I have to just say this. Like, just in case any fan remembers about this, one Bison dollar will be 10 British pounds. Seriously?
Well, at least they decided to go away from the norm instead of, you know, scowly, bad, broody, bad guy who just wants to destroy the world because he can.
Well, he can. He's proving it. And he also has a good marketing strategy. So, that's Storm King. What else?
I don't really know what the bad guy's troops are called.
The pirates?
Those big...
The henchmen, sir.
I'll just call them Yetis for the sake of making it easy. Like, they're not explained what they are. They're just the brute force. And the small one, which is Grubber, he just exists purely for comic relief. He does absolutely nothing else.
In all honesty, I do agree.
He's the announcer.
Yeah, I do agree that putting Michael Pena in that role was kind of genius, but from what we got on screen and from what they were hyping up, I think they wasted their money. Like, Hasbro wasted their money on Michael Pena.
No, I think he did add his own kind of flair to the show, comical as it is. But it's an MLP movie. You can't be too rooted in the main story. You had to have something. I mean, Derpy is around and Derpy is always... And in several episodes, in the normal... weekly episodes, Derpy adds a little bit of fun into it. She's not required, to be honest, and again, nothing against any Derpy fans out there, but even if she's not around, the show would be, she doesn't need to be there, but she's there and adds another dimension to it.
Well, that's true, but when you think about it, right, in terms of what he gave to the show and what, like, just think about it, like, what he gave and what was given, it's like, not really. You didn't need to be there to... Like, I understand you have to be the comic relief kind of character, but you didn't really need to be there at all. Like, the scene would have done well. I mean, yeah, you're there, you exist, okay, you like to eat candies or treats, so, yeah, I mean, that's what I took out of it. Like, to me, he's kind of a throwaway character that if he's there, it's cool. If he's not there, he's cool. Mm. Like, to me, when you say Michael Pena's going to be in the movie, right, I think about Ant-Man. Like, think about how Ant-Man was and how his character was there. And he at least gave something to it. Like, his comedic timing was absolutely perfect, especially the scene where he explained to Ant-Man about how someone saw Spider-Man, blah, 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 and so on. And or how he explained something about a project. Like, that whole scene there was awesome. And I don't think they use him properly in terms of his talent and his capability.
To be honest, I don't know who the actor is, and to me, it doesn't really matter to me who the actor is, but the Grubber character itself, I felt, was worth being there. You may disagree with me, Norman, in that case, but I think Grubber's character there, it worked out for me. I actually enjoyed his silliness.
Alright. I mean, at least he was there for something, and some people like it or not, right?
Yeah, he had a purpose. He basically says all the nonsense that Tempest doesn't have to say, because if she were to say any of the stuff that he had to say, it would have might have broken her character.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, it would have brought her character down in her... Yeah, break her character would be right, lah.
Yeah, and I think her threat, her menace, her appearance, like, if she were to say, oh, that's over, like, that came out of left field. So,
Yeah, she doesn't have a humorous bone in her body.
Oh, yeah. Maybe it's gone because of one part.
Oh, funny.
But I think Emily Blunt did a damn good job, though.
Oh, yes, totally. I totally agree. Like, we talk about the actors later. What about the pirates?
I actually like the pirates.
Yeah, I do. I like the pirates.
they didn't seem to... They didn't really get much screen time. But at least they are, like, pretty unique. And also, you know what's going to happen. Oh, there's a new species of creature on the show, and it's canon. Unleash the OCs! It happened when the Diamond Dogs came out.
Oh, true. And that was a while back. And the pirates, like... Yeah, they were awesome. Like, seriously, the pirates were awesome. I it's hard for me to explain why I like them without spoiling the whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
But they were awesome. Like, the appearance, first thing first, they're parrots.
Yep.
Kind of parrots. I think they're parrots.
I think they're like parrots or birds or something.
They're avians, like, at least. They're avians.
Yeah, they're avians. But when you think about it, like, wow, you guys are really... weird.
Yeah, but I like the reason of them being parrots, because if you think of pirates, your standard pirate always has a parrot on his shoulder, so the parrot becomes the pirate. It's a very nice twist to it.
True. And on top of that, their artwork, their style, and what do you call this, like, their whole thing is the design is really good. And the song that they had in there, I think, is available on YouTube if you want to go check it out. It's awesome.
Oh, funny. Yes, good pun.
That came to me. But still, I'm trying to look for the actress name who played the pirate captain. Captain... Who
was name? Calino.
Castellano. Like, wow.
Hard to pronounce name.
Yeah. I'm trying
Why,
to
Hasbro?
Her name, because... She, if I can get it right, cast please. The actress who played the Captain Pirate is the same actress who played Gamora from Guardians of the Galaxy.
Big names, though.
Michelle Krieger's in the movie, really now?
Huh. Yeah, they actually had quite a few big names in the movie for this one.
Michelle Krieger is the actress played Apple Bloom.
Yeah, but what does she get to voice this time?
I don't know. I'm just looking at IMDb right now as we talk. And give me a second. I'm trying to look for the actress's name. I'm guessing people on the internet already found her name. But, oi. But, like, I'll just complete my sentence. Zoe Saldana. That's her.
Oh, you found it. Okay, cool.
So, anyway, Zoe, she played Gamora from Guardians of the Galaxy. She also played the blue alien from Avatar.
Really?
Yes, she did. So she's being an alien. It's nothing new for her. So I think she played her role quite well. And the thing is, I didn't really know that was her. When you hear her voice, when you see the acting, like, did you know that was Gamora?
No, I did not.
Like, no. Wow, that was just too good. Like, too awesome. Dragon, what do you think of the captain?
Well, she is spunky. I really did like her. It was quite nice on how... Okay, again, I don't want to spoil anything, so I'm not going to say it. But at the end of the day, the character from when the main six meets her to the end of the movie, you can see a really big change, and I enjoyed it. I mean, you could see her character is there, but very... You know what? You know, I'm not going to stop it right there. But I'm just going to leave it at... From the moment they met her till the point at the end of the show, the character did really well as the actress did really well in playing her role, as well as the fact that the character evolved. Could you say that maybe? We're not trying to spoil it. Yeah, the flow from the very beginning to the end was actually quite good. I enjoyed the pirate. In a way, I enjoyed all of the pirates. That they were, each one of them had their own characteristics. It was quite good to watch.
True. And let's go for Capper. I was sitting between two girls. Mm-hmm. They're part of our group. And I think one of our buddies, Amy, she really, really likes Tay Diggs.
Who?
Okay.
Oh, whoops.
Capper.
Yeah, right.
And what do you guys think of Capper? I think he was kind of a cool character. He's very charming. He's the con artist character, the tropish kind of thing. Gravity swoos over him.
That made Spike upset.
Yeah. And what do you think of him? I personally like him. And the voice actor, Tay Diggs, did a good voice. The actor Tay Diggs really did a good job.
I feel that if they gave him a sword and he got him to fight, he would have been a very good Puss and Boots kind of character. But no, so his charisma is there. Puss and Boots, Puss is a character, charisma is there. So yeah, he was a good character, but I kind of wish they gave him one or two more layers, if you know what I mean. Mm. He was very, very two-dimensional to a point.
He got a lot more layers at the end of the movie. Yeah. You'll understand later.
But the thing is, in the comics, there's more. If you go read the comics, the prequel comics, there's more. And here's the thing. I like his character not because of what I read in the comics, but you guys mentioning that, I wish he had more layers. Bing! The prequel comic did give him a few layers.
Alright, then I have to read the comics then. I haven't got a chance to read them
yet. And they even explain some... Well, not really explain. Sorry, the prequel comic explains something that happened later on, where there's the loan shark guy named... Verko, the mole kind of character. He was going to do something with something, and he says Caper says, I got something that can settle my debt in full. And in the prequel comic it explains what
If I read that, then the movie will, that segment will make a lot more sense.
Yes, but as far as you guys know, it could have been this guy did something and then owes a lot of debt, standard con character. Yeah.
Okay, I'm not going to spoil it for the fans, but when you see that scene that what Capper owes, what's the guy's name again?
Verko.
That scene, I love Rarity's reaction. That was funny. Okay, you go watch it.
Yes. So, moving on to the hippos. Or the sea ponies in this case.
Hippos are funny.
Yep.
Look for the hippos.
So, Princess Skystar, her character, what do you guys think? Is she the typical fish out of water character? I'm using fish out of water.
Badum-tsh.
No, but honestly, do you think that she's the typical Disney princess that I want more kind of thing, Ariel or...
No, she's just really, really, really bored.
She's also extremely perky. I think she'll give Pinkie Pie a run for her money for being perky.
True. So, Ash, what do you think of the princess Skystar?
Also probably going to be an unpopular opinion. I think the sea ponies do absolutely nothing for the movie. If the movie didn't have them in it, also it would have been exactly the same to me. thinly veiled marketing ploy to sell more toys by Hasbro.
True, I don't doubt you on that. Okay. But what do you think of...
I like Queen Novo more. She sass.
But what do you think of Christine Kensworth, like, as her voice acting?
Acting was alright. Basically, they managed to convey, like, a possibly very, very bored princess who's very excitable to see new people. And she definitely has a heart in the right place. Like, spoiler. She's there in the trailer. You figure it out.
Yeah. Right.
Yes, we have censored it so that you do not hear what's going on.
And what do you guys think of Queen Novo?
Oh, I like her. I like the voice actor a lot too.
Yeah.
She's like my second favorite character in the movie behind Tempest.
Yeah. And voice actress for Queen Novo is Uzo Aduba.
Yeah, I don't really know the voice actor because this is my first time coming across her.
Mm-hmm. I haven't heard that name either, actually.
I think she played a few roles besides this one. I mean, come on, she's very popular. I think she plays Orange is the New Black. What else did she play? Ooh, she played in Steven Universe, really, now.
Wow.
Who?
Bismuth.
Oh, yeah, watch it.
Bismuth.
Bismuth. Bismuth.
Yeah, I know the character, but I don't actually watch the show.
Neither do I.
Well, she does a lot, and she's also SNL alumni. That's cool. But still, back onto ponies. The queen, you say you like her, she has a lot of sass. What do you think overall?
When I originally saw her, you see like this majestic, off-white, slightly pinkish. I'm not entirely 100% sure what color is she.
Quote unquote Celestia.
Yeah, she's got.
I thought it was
she's
more
got,
cream than anything else, but okay.
Yeah, but the art on the sticker shows she's pink, but when you look at her movie, she looks like very, very white, almost pink. I'm not sure anymore.
So basically, she's Celestia Fishhorn.
Almost.
Yeah, you're right. See, the stickers does show that she's more pink than anything else.
But yeah, when you look at it, you expect her to be like maybe this regal princess or something.
Like Celestia.
Yeah. Then suddenly she comes out and I'm like, damn, girl, like, whoa.
I was like,
that's not a word. Fam, I love this lady already.
Well, but the thing is, she's not a princess, she's a queen.
But to explain it better, you look at Princess Celestia, that's supposed to be a queen.
Well, yeah,
supposed to be.
She was a queen in the original Bible story, but they changed it for marketing reasons. But
of course,
the end, that's how you supposed to act like a queen. But no, man, like, she ain't taking no.
Mama ain't taking no.
That's not a word.
Yeah. So, her character was interesting. I like the voice actress for her, and yeah, she's overall enjoyable.
It's a shame she doesn't have more lines.
True.
What the hell?
Yeah, but when her facial expression softened a bit. Again, no spoilers, but when her facial expression softened a bit later in the show, you could see a sense of, you know, softening and willing to accept that kind of feeling. And yeah, I'm just going to leave it at that. Mm-hmm. But it was nice to see that scene, actually.
True. Mm. And
yeah, but then again, I wouldn't be too harsh on her character before the softening, because having a daughter that perky, yeah, I probably get a headache too.
Yeah, Pinkie Pie fish form.
Yeah, so that's overall the new characters. I think we didn't cover the Storm King's actor, right?
Yeah, I think we didn't bring up who was the voice actor for the Storm King.
So he is Levi Schreiber. You may know him from shows like X-Men Wolverine Origins. He plays Sabretooth.
What?
Okay. Yes, I know, right? And he also plays other stories involving a very, very bad guy that kills a lot of people. And the only reason why he did this movie was so he can have a movie where his kids, young, I think around 8 to 9 or so, can watch this movie.
Daddy's in the show. Daddy's in the show.
Yes.
So it was technically for the lulz.
Technically
of
for
his
the
children's,
kids. Yeah.
Children's lulz.
And honestly, I do like his acting. He really portrayed the Storm King really, really well. Unfortunately for, I won't say him, but the writers didn't really use him to the fullest.
Yeah.
Yeah, he to be honest, even though the Storm King was supposed to be the main bad guy in the show, he was kind of forgettable as far as I'm concerned.
And to be honest, right, the prequel comic do him justice.
Oh, so the comics did him justice, but the movie itself made him quite sad.
Yes, there's a few things. Okay, I'll spoil, quote-unquote, the prequel comic so you go buy, so you guys can go buy it and read it. First thing, the Storm King had a second in command. And he was thinking about, oh, all this power I have, but I don't have anything to, I don't have anyone to share it with. I should probably get a friend or something like that. Huh? I have my second in command, this shadow person guy. He's kind of my good buddy. So I think I'm going to open up. Shadow buddy person backsteps in. And they're like, oh, yeah, nice timing. Then later on, Storm King gets revenge, destroys the shadow person thingy. Then, at the end of the prequel comic, book 4, Storm King asks Tempest to... No, not really asks. Tempest's whole thing is to get something. Tempest stole something from the Storm King, got it back, and the Tempest asks, what you want to do with it? Oh, simple. Destroys item. Just because he doesn't want any other power. Like, he doesn't want anybody else to have the power. Mm-hmm. So, he wants to have the ultimate power. Like, he's the only bad guy that has the power. It's the same scenario, like, if all guns are gone, but except I have the only gun, that makes me all mighty and powerful kind of scenario.
Ah, okay.
So, the prequel comic does justice. So, go read it if you get the chance. It's really worth.
Okay.
So, to reiterate, he had a shadow something person as his second in command. Then he got backstabbed. Then... after that, he got another shadow something to replace that.
Like, when I say shadow person, it's really smoke shadow thingy kind of character.
Ah, but okay.
Doesn't have to do with whatever is in the past. This is just OC character that's meant to be killed off.
okay.
So, that's for the new characters and their prequel comics. What about the existing ones? The quote-unquote main seven.
Oh, all right. You are including Spike.
Yes. How could you forget him?
It took me a second when you said seven. Spike is so forgettable.
Oh, wow.
Dragons exist to be exploited.
Well, you now you can see where Dragon Breath Round comes from.
You know, he's so exploited that when he turned them into... wait, hold on. The underwater part is in the trailer, right?
Yes.
So I can say this without spoiler. I pity poor Spike. Why the hell did they turn him into that underwater creature?
You know, why did they turn him into a dog in the Equestria Girls movie? Mm. So it's like, poor Spike, he's always getting the short end of the stick.
Okay. Yeah, it was also quite funny when the poor fella didn't know what was going on. What's happening to me? Whoop.
But for the main characters, let's go for Twilight first. Like, Twilight in this movie has an interesting development from start to end. Like, this is really spoilering. Like,
yeah, you really want to bring that up?
No. So, the thing is, development for Twilight is there, even though if people might predict it 10 yards away, like, mm-hmm. I think, to me, well, for me, I don't really think so, like, I can understand the development.
Reason behind things, is it?
Yes, I can understand reasons behind the things, and it does develop her character well, makes her more of a character, like, it develops her 7 plus years of character building, so like that.
I guess you can say it matures her slightly, like the way some of the characters behave, like I personally, when I look at it, it's like, God, why did you do that? You're an idiot. But in the end of the day, it still fits their personality. Like, Applejack is stubborn, Pinkie Pie is made of, it's a ball of energy that trusts people too much. Rarity is vain.
And melodramatic.
Yeah, I think it comes in the same package. Buy one, free one. And Rainbow Dash has an ego size of a blimp. So if you watch the movie, like, you may look at it and say, God, why do you do this? It's so idiotic. Are you stupid or something? And I'm sure Twilight will agree with me in some of the situations. Mm-hmm. But at the end of the day, it still ties in the character. They will act that way because that is what they are like.
Yes. And that's the thing that I find it enjoyable, because some of their cons are their pros in their own world. Like, if you pull them out of that world, for example, Pinkie Pie being too trusting and whatnot, being a bit too loud, in a world of, let's just say they're in Mos Eisley. Not in the best place. Like, oh, they're... oh, God, no.
She'd be skinned and sold into slavery so fast.
Yep, totally. But the thing is, Pinkie Pie is going to be Pinkie Pie no matter what you do. She's going to be that...
Yeah, reminds me of our friend Saint Pinky.
Oh yeah. But hey, he's going to be him, and
yeah, he's going to be him.
And Applejack's going to be honest and things. But I heard I read a review that a fan kind of linked to me and synopsized for me.
Mm-hmm.
It says that some of the characters are not even worth it. Like, if Fluttershy was not there, the movie would have still continued on without her. Fluttershy, Applejack, and Rarity. These three characters, if they were not there, things would have been okay. Like,
yeah, you are right about that.
The only characters that made a difference was Pinkie, Twilight, and Rainbow Dash.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know how to say this, but I kind of expected it. It's like there for reasons. Like, I kind of expected this to happen. So it's like, well, yeah. If they had more time, like if they had 2 hours to work with, probably. But...
So it all goes back to the whole Hasbro or whoever developed it is rushing it again.
Kind of.
Yeah.
But if you actually do analyze deeper into the movie, again, spoilers, so I'm just going to try and summarize it. They do actually play their certain parts. Like, Rarity actually... plays a relatively important part, even as small as it is.
It's minute, but
it's minute, but it's there and it's still important. And Applejack also has a role, even though it comes very, very late, and it's still there. Fluttershy, on the other hand, I've got no idea what she's supposed to do.
Like, that's the problem with Fluttershy for most cases, because even in the series, people don't really know what to do with her. Like, they always do the whole, oh, I'm meek, I'm shy. Oh, please, somebody.
Then
that's not a word!
Comes out the whole
that's not a word!
Yeah.
Everybody back off.
Yep, yep.
Yeah, she talks down a dragon. How nice is that? Early episodes, by the way.
Yeah, but that's the thing. Like, that's always the default for writers when they write Fluttershy. So, for the movie scale, like, well, I do like this one scene where Fluttershy... I do like this one scene where Fluttershy talks a guy down, so yeah, that's okay, that's awesome and funny and cool, so yeah. But still, it's part of her charm. But the thing is, in the movie, it was kind of wasted potential. Like, but the thing is, what could she really do in that huge situation? Like, she's out of her element altogether.
Yeah, quite. Because, like, even on a normal episode, she's like relatively quiet and uninvolved. Like, unless the episode is entirely settles around her.
And Discord.
Yeah.
And Discord.
And, talking about Discord, right? Things could have been easily solved.
What, if they pulled in Discord?
Yes! Think about it!
But I'm reformed, I don't do this.
That's not a word!
Anymore, no. I don't want Celestia turning me into a statue again, no.
You know, that's funny seeing, well, I'm not going to say anything, but the movie, you'll find out, if you're going to watch the movie, you'll find out why I say that's funny when Ash said, Celestia would turn me into a statue.
yeah. But, I think we covered most of the main six, because I think Twilight has the most development.
Yeah, well, she is supposed to be the princess of friendship, and the whole thing revolves around friendship, so yeah, she had the most development.
Yeah, and I think for the rest of the characters, they're still the same. They support Twilight. And like I mentioned before, the most screen time or the most important characters, quote-unquote, for this movie was Rainbow Dash and Pinkie Pie and Twilight. If the rest were not there, things would have gone without have no difference.
Actually, you know? I'm just going to say this a little bit just for the fun of it. Ash, you mentioned this earlier in the show. No, the most important character in the whole movie is Derpy. Go find out why.
Derpy is the real MVP. Figure it out. Yeah,
go watch the movie and tell us that you disagree.
Yes. Derp porn is better.
Click the like button if you agree with me.
I think that's... okay, one more character. Three more characters, actually. The princesses.
They're token characters. They're there just to show you that they're there.
Yeah,
and that's about it.
And their eyes are freaky. Like, their art are almost the same. They didn't change anything about their looks, but their eyes.
Oh, I didn't notice the eyes. What was about
that? I feel that everybody's eyes were extra big in this movie compared to normal. And sparkly.
Yes, but problem is, well, not really a big problem, the princess's eyes. They're too big.
I did not notice that. I only noticed that Twilight's eyes were too damn big. Honestly.
Everybody's eyes were too damn big.
But
and all the ponies were chubby. It's like, before the movie started, everyone had like 6 cakes every day.
I think that's only on your end. Maybe. Did you agree with him? No.
Do you find that they're chubby?
I don't feel that they're chubbier, but their faces seem to be a lot more expressive.
Oh, okay.
It's not like the same animation quality as nyam, 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 nyam. It's like, you can see that actually they move more.
Yeah, but their faces are so round.
Well, that's me.
Camera puts on 10 pounds.
True that.
Movie cameras are even worse.
But I also think that I also think that DHX using Toon Boom instead of... Flash is a wise choice and wise change because animating in Toon Boom, from what I can understand, is much more fluid and much more efficient.
Ah, that might explain it.
Yes, and it looks really, really good. Like, oh wow.
You know what I enjoyed really in the show, and I'm not talking about story or anything spoilery, but what I enjoyed was there is once or twice in the show where they actually followed the Pegasus in flight.
Oh, that's very
loved that. No, there was also once in the very end, but I'm not going to say where. But they followed the Pegasus in flight, and I actually loved that. It was like we were watching from the Pegasus point of view of doing a flyby. That was awesome.
Yeah, and technically, that's huge budget. Like, the money was spent there. Like, if you have a video game, that one scene, yeah, that was that. But this one, like, My Little Pony movie.
Personally, I loved that scene. It was like awesome.
Yeah. And, well, what else did we cover? We covered the Wing 6, new characters.
Alright, what about following up on what I mentioned? Is there any part of the show that is non-spoilery but nice that you think that you enjoy watching? Like I said, I love following the Pegasus in flight. Is there anything that's cinematic or animation that you liked from the show?
In all honesty, the end scene, that was nice, but that would be a cop-out because end scenes are always the best. But I think I would say this one scene where Twilight did some magic to do something part where everybody was free-falling. That part was awesome.
That was good. That was a quick thinking on her part. But yeah,
that was not quick thinking. That was pre-planned.
That was pre-planned. Sorry. One of the other ponies said that was quick thinking, but yeah, fair enough. It was pre-planned.
Yeah, but it technically was quick thinking. She had only 3 seconds to think of something within that time. She take a look, see at everything she had, and then like, okay, let's do this.
Twilight has brains.
Oh, she always has. What about you, Ash?
I think one of my favorite scenes was probably when Equestria was being invaded. apart from that, I don't know really. I kind of like the movie, like, generally as a whole. Like, I don't really have a favorite song either. But I think, like, but among all the songs which I heard in the movie, I think the opening song was probably the best.
Mm-hmm. Which one was that? The friendship song, was it?
Before or the very beginning or the one where Rainbow Dash started everything?
The one at the very beginning.
Ah, that one.
Like, the first time I watched the movie, I totally missed the intro. I walked in just as the bad guy showed up. So
that was your first viewing.
Yeah, that's my first viewing. I missed the entire chunk of it. So like, now that I actually watched it with the beginning part, and yes, I hassled Norman like crazy to get in. We're gonna miss the intro.
Well,
changed the tone of the movie by a lot.
We got in like one advertisement before the movie started, right?
A couple of advertisements.
Okay.
Because when we went in, a couple started. We were confused about seating because I forgot to mention one number, and then I think the three of us had to go to the toilet
individually, of course.
Oh yes. It would be strange to go at the same time. But still, that was that. And when we came in, I think we had to suffer one ad.
We got to watch a cool turn off your phone advertisement, including ponies.
Oh, yeah.
And also about PSA about drugs, I remember that.
There was that shot before the...
Oh, yes, it was there.
Yeah, I forgot to mention because, okay, Patreon supporters, Master of Lag, he told me, am I going to review Hanazuki?
Mm-hmm.
I was confused because why would I want to review Hanazuki? That's a entirely, totally different show that doesn't have to do with ponies. Mm-hmm. He told me that that's going to be in the beginning, like the quote-unquote, the Pixar kind of
thing. Yeah. Before a Pixar movie, there's another short skit or something.
Yeah, and he said that's what's going to be there, and he says something, I don't really... purely remember because I tried to blank things out for this scenario, for this movie. And, that's there. Okay. And I think the animation for this one was bump up a bit for movie reasons. I have to say, Hanazuki was kind of cool. I might go watch it. And if I'm not mistaken, this was created by Dave Polsky, one of the writers, or written by him. Dave Polsky is one of the writers for My Little Pony. He did a few episodes. I think one of the episodes he did was Twilight Time. So,
Twilight Time. Okay.
Yeah, but some people like it, some people hate it, but that's
besides the point.
So I think I might try and watch Hanazuki. Yeah, and I think this is what Hasbro was banging in for people to kind of try something new.
The artwork kind of looked like a Steven Universe meets Adventure Time, if you ask me. So, yeah, it's not something I enjoyed. Sorry.
What about you?
Hanazuki, I think I know it more as a toy line.
Didn't it start out to be some kind of art online kind of deal, and then
I'm not really familiar with it, so I can't really say.
Same here. Like, I heard somebody told me something like that, but I couldn't get a confirmation. So it was kind of interesting to watch it in person and fun. But yeah, Hanazuki was at the beginning. It was there and it was fun. And other than that, what else? Like, what else are we missing? I think we're almost done, right?
Attention to detail.
Oh.
That's one thing I want to talk about. If you were to look throughout the movie, mostly in the areas that where you can actually see Equestria, because everywhere else is like new characters you've never seen before. Mm-hmm. Like, you see background characters you recognize everywhere in the background. You see Minuet, you see Caramel, see them all in the background.
and you see Pixie, you see Starlight. Yeah.
And some of them actually had voices. We had a few of them had voices.
I think Apple Cobbler was in the front or something.
I don't remember.
Something like that. Like you saw that, I saw the Doctor a few times, and by the Doctor, I mean Doctor Who.
Oh, I thought you were talking about the Doctor that's sitting several seats below us.
even in one of the dancing scenes, you had like a whole bunch of ponies look exactly the same, but they took the effort to give them all different cutie marks. Like, the attention to detail is there, and like, bravo, clappy clap.
Okay, you watched it for a second time. I did not notice the different cutie marks.
I noticed it the first time around,
I did not notice the different cutie marks.
I noticed a few things, like their dancing was pretty awesome.
Oh,
the
yes.
Cutie marks was not there because I was more looking at their hair, like, okay.
How do you see through all those locks?
No, it's not that one. Like, I think some of the characters have black and grey, the others have black and yellow. That's cool. And the dancing was like all over the place. Like, oh wow, okay, the animation budget was there too. And talking about one other character that we forgot to mention is Sia. Songbird Serenade.
Oh, Songbird Serenade.
We totally forget about her. And that's how she is. Totally forgettable.
I think she was just there for the star power.
Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, like, before the movie, I had no idea who she was.
Okay, I'm going to get shot here, but who is Sia again? She's a singer. She's an actual singer.
She is an actual singer who is quite popular. And from what I understand, she's from Australia, down under, if I'm not mistaken.
This kind of reminds me of like in the Zootopia, where they actually brought in Shakira to come and sing as Gazelle.
Yeah, but technically, Shakira or Gazelle, something like that, I forgot her name, she kind of played a part in the movie.
Yeah, a small part. There's a speaking role as well. But
it technically kind of pushed that character, or pushed the scene, or pushed the movie towards this one angle that it was aiming for. And Shakira or Gazella or something like that.
No, Gazelle. Just Gazelle.
Yeah, Gazelle kind of aimed for, like, oh wow, she's kind of a throwaway character, but she was memorable.
How could you say Gazelle's a throwaway character? She was important.
Yeah, but the thing is, Gazelle was there, she did her part, and it was awesome. But in the end, if she was not there, movie would still have...
No, I disagree. I personally feel that Gazelle was important to the show, both as a singing role, as a character that had a bit... Even though she had a few lines, I think she's important. But again, this is just a little bit of sidetracking for Zootopia. As much as the show was good, let's get back to the actual... Okay, so Sia was... what was her name again?
Songbird Serenade.
I feel that it was nice that she was there. And to be honest, she only had... she appeared like in the beginning, somewhere in the middle. Again, no spoilers. Somewhere in the middle she appeared. And at the end, it's enough.
Yeah,
I think it's enough.
It's technically enough, but... Come on, it's a pony show. We want our quote-unquote cameo character because...
Oh, so you wanted Rara back, is it?
Yes!
Okay, fair enough. Rara back would have been nice.
But no.
But she lost her status.
At least we got cheese sandwich.
Yes, cheese was there. But
speaking role.
Sad luck.
Better than nothing.
Okay, but come on. See, you got cheese sandwich, who is Weird Al. He had his own 22-minute episode.
Mm-hmm.
That was quite awesome. You had William Shatner, who shared his screen time with...
I remember
Alicia Days.
I remember William Shatner being in it, but what was his role again? I forgot.
Grandpa Pear.
Oh, he was Grandpa Pear, right. Grandpa Pear.
Yeah. But you also had Felicia Days, who was in the same episode, who played Bright Max, the father. I forgot the name, but still, you had the same thing going on. So it's like, you had a lot of things going on for you. Like, okay, you had your own episode. I think, like, for Sia, I would like it if Hasbro would pay her to have her own My Little Pony episode in season 8. Like,
That would be nice.
Yeah, at least have her own thing. So at least give us justification for her reason to be there.
That would be good, because then it shows that there are more than just one or two stars in the MLP universe.
Yeah,
There'll be more singing stars in there.
Yeah, I mean, you can get Songbird Serenade and Contes Coloratura and have them battle. And you can also have Sia battle with who's the name? I forgot. She won a Grammy or something like that.
Sapphire Shores.
No.
Sapphire Shores is also a singer. Wow, I forgot about her.
In canon, but she's not a real singer. I'm talking about the Contes Coloratura, her actress who played her.
Wow, I actually remembered her name before. I totally forgot it now.
I don't think I've caught up to there yet.
You need to catch up with some of the shows, like, seriously. But I know you're strapped
like,
on time, I
it's
know.
It's like, okay, I've only watched like maybe up to season 3. Like, I know everything between season 1 and season 3. Then I stopped for a good long while. Then I saw a picture of Sea King Thorax online. Sure.
T-Rex.
No, Thorax. Changeling, the new Changeling King.
Hold on, sorry. It's Lena Hall.
Yes, Lena Hall.
Ah, there we go. Okay, sorry, Ash. Back to you.
I saw a picture of him, then I'm like, what the heck? Then I went to watch again. So I caught up a few more episodes. So like, Starshine Glimmer is now Twilight's Apprentice.
That was cool.
And some other things, but I'm still missing big chunks here and there, because it's just like, I really had a WTF. Like, what the hell is that?
Hopefully you have the time to binge watch a few episodes then.
Yes. I finished watching Shokugeki no Soma already, so yeah, I'm free now.
Oh, I haven't seen season 3 yet, but that's another topic.
It just started a while ago, but yeah, that's totally different. Yeah. Anime belongs in a different world.
Okay, so, but when you mentioned that character, the couple of characters now, I enjoyed the episode with T-Rex. Maybe because I still remember the first episode of My Little Pony back in the 80s. It was Escape from Midnight Castle. That was awesome. So when they brought T-Rex back, I'm like, really? He's back? Oh, cool. Then like, I saw this wrinkled old prune. Okay, he's gonna get bigger somehow.
Yes, he did. And the way he did was awesome.
Yes. Ash mentioned T-Rex, and T-Rex is my favorite bad guy. Yeah, honestly.
But speaking of coming back, I feel that the Storm King would have been great as a recurring villain for the series.
Yes.
Would have been fantastic.
Yeah, but unfortunately he got his check and ran out.
Huh? Oh, yeah.
Cashed his check.
He ain't coming back. No way.
Yeah, yeah. He's getting his check. He got his check. He's out the window now. Like, oh,
yeah. Like, here's a pink slip. Shoo.
Yep, no, not pink slip. He took his check and went out. If we really explain it, it will be spoiler. So you guys go watch it.
It's so hard to hold ourselves back. Every time I see something, like, oh,
that's not a word.
Spoilers.
Yeah. Maybe sometime later we'll do another talk where we will just bring up everything.
Yes.
Now it's too early.
Yes, it's too early. Plus we'll...
So how do you think? 1 week later, we do another one. And then this time, it's like, you haven't watched it? Shame on you. Too bad.
I'll have to think about it. I have to ask my other crews. But I think we are almost an hour in. And this was supposed to be a 30-minute thing.
That never happens.
Yes, I know. But anywho, let's wrap it up. People like to give ratings. I think Rotten Tomato give it 57 out of
100%. I thought it was a little higher than that.
I heard about that. Like, critics were like really slamming it really bad, but user reviews were giving it good.
91% on user reviews. A lot of places in the Rotten Tomato scenes were kind of all over the place. So I am not 100% sure. If you guys are checking it out, please do. I give my official rating.
Okay. According to this, My Little Pony, the movie 2017. Oh, what the hell? Go away, foreigner. That's another movie I want to watch.
6.8 over 10 for IMDb.
Oh, that 55%
on Rotten Tomatoes. And Roger Ebert gave it 1.5 out of 4.
So wait, Rotten Tomatoes 60 plus?
No. Rotten Tomatoes is 55%.
Oh.
But according to Rotten Tomatoes website, the audience score is 88%.
Oh,
so you can see how different it is.
Yeah, and the Google user score for this is 90%, like this movie.
Oh, wow. So what about us three here? Like, the guys who watch it and the guys who are not getting paid to do this. So for me personally, I like the movie. I enjoyed it. It has its ups, it has its downs. The story to me was not predictable.
Oh, yes, it was.
To me.
Well, to me too.
Like, to Tomato. Me, it was almost predictable. Like, you get a sense of where things are going. But in the end, it's a pony movie or it's a pony show. So things that I was expecting were there. So it's like, oh, okay, this is going to happen. So yeah, all right, okay, I see things, how it goes. And I think the animation budget for this one was awesome. The voice acting was awesome also. The song was awesome. And yeah, they're going to get a lot of money out of the soundtrack and a lot of views on YouTube.
Oh yeah,
true.
And for me, I will give it an 8 out of 10. Like, it's not that perfect, but it's not that... it's not going to be around a 5 or 6 or 7. I think it deserves the 8. Like, I were to give a 7, it would be something like Blade Runner 2049. Like, I know a lot of people may like it, but to me, Blade Runner is a 7.
I enjoy Blade Runner, but then that's another...
I haven't watched it yet, so I can't say.
But there's something else completely. So I give it an 8 out of 10. What about you, Dragon?
Alright, let's see. I enjoyed the movie. I enjoyed the characters. The songs were awesome. All the new characters that came out were great. Personally, let's say, Saint Pinky is going to watch the show again on this Saturday. If I had the time, I would probably join him as well. That's how much I like the show. However, liking to watch it and my personal rating, it's a little different. I would watch it again, definitely. But personally, I give it a rating of 7 over 10. It wasn't the best show. It was predictable as heck. But I enjoyed it. So it's kind of conflicting there. So I wouldn't be too generous, nor would I be too much of a critic. I'm kind of like, Simon Cowell after he's been told off not to be too harsh on people.
All right.
So it's a 7/10 for me.
All right.
And if they extended it to at least 2 hours, maybe a bit higher, because things wouldn't be so rushed.
All right. Yeah.
But it's an MLP movie.
Anesh?
Okay. I'm gonna say it on two different spectrums here, because I did watch it as a movie reviewer once and the second time as a fan. So, on the first run, I would say that the movie is nothing groundbreaking. At the end of the day, it's still a kids movie. Animation is good. Characters are quite likable. And it's not a one-dimensional kids show. Like, most kids shows, like, they'll go out on some epic adventure and then run into some tiny problems and then they'll save the day. Here, like, if you watch it, there is a genuine feeling of, like, hopelessness. Like, the situation is, like, really bad. The show is actually pretty serious. If you look at it, it's not all fun, games, sparkles, with magic, no, and that's my name. But at the end of the day, it's still a kid's show, so the plot is fairly predictable. So from the movie reviewer side, I would say it's a 6.5 at very best.
But 6.5
As a reviewer. It's not a bad show, but I cannot give it like a really high score based on everything in it, because it's not a show meant for my demographic. I like gritty stuff. I like blood. I like gore. I like explosions.
And you might like Blade Runner then.
Yeah, I'm not the right demographic. So if you would have asked me to watch it like 20 years ago, maybe I would have enjoyed it a lot more. But as a fan, I would give it an 8, because I see loads of references. The characters are likable. The designs are nice. It's something I know and something that I love. So as a fan, I enjoy it a lot more. So that's basically my take on it.
Yeah, and I can totally agree. Like, if I were in a situation where I was quote-unquote dragged in to watch something that I don't really understand, I will view it as a casual.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, like, if you know some certain details about X movie, then you'll give it Y score. So yeah, it's understandable.
Yeah, because like, as fans, we're all naturally biased. So.
Yes, totally. So, well, that's our quote-unquote discussion for the technically it's not the first My Little Pony movie. That was way back when they did the My Little Pony movie, the very first one.
I'm trying to remember the very first My Little Pony. I can't remember it right now.
Why it has something to do with Firefly getting a human to the pony world.
Escape
from Katrina Manor or something.
No. Firefly getting a human friend, isn't that?
Ooh.
No, that's Midnight Castle.
I don't remember. But still, that was the first My Little Pony movie in theaters. I'm talking about the 2017 one.
Okay. So, fair enough.
So that's our thought and discussion for that movie. And well, if you guys would like to support the show, you can do so at patreon.com/the MBS show. I'm guessing I'll be putting this one out on Patreon before I put it on YouTube. But still, you can do so, like I mentioned, patreon.com/MBS show, and with every support, you guys can get early access to this, exclusives and deleted contents, and also a huge thanks from me. And talking about thank yous, I would like to thank Nurgle Cat, Nandragatorius, Starstream, and also Master of Black. Thank you guys for the awesome support. So anyway, I have been Norman Sanzo.
This is Jewel Eater Dragon.
And Ash.
And we'll guys catch you next time with another episode of the MBS show. See ya.
Bye.
Later.